In this video, we will showcase how our system supports communication across space and time. We illustrate this with a scenario, the workday with an asynchronous reality. The scenario takes place in a small game studio. The team is in the middle of their current project. To promote the game, they want to release an action figure that is based on one of their game characters. They already want to start developing the action figure so that it can be released at the same time as the game. Today, they want to create a 3D printed prototype of it. There is already an animated in-game version of the character. Two team members, Joe and Anna, discuss how to make it suitable for 3D printing.
Right now, the model of the character is one connected mesh.
No immersive technology is involved in this step. The team members simply discuss at a whiteboard while the system captures the sketch. They conclude that the model needs to be split into three parts. Joe then returns to his desk and starts creating the 3D print version. At some point, Anna casually drops by Joe's office.
Hey.
Oh, hey.
I just wanted to know how it's going with the models.
Pretty good. I think I'm almost done.
Great. You can just call me when they're done. I will be at my desk.
This was a co-located synchronous interaction. Upon finishing the 3D models, Joe calls Anna.
I'm done separating the mesh. Do you think it's printable now?
Let me see.
Yeah, looks like the pieces are fitting together. I'll start printing.
This was a remote synchronous interaction. From here, things get asynchronous. After sending the models to Anna, Joe wants to work on the game logic for the rest of the day. So he turns on focus mode. To block distractions, noise is played back for Joe and only objects in close proximity are rendered. While Joe is focused on programming, Anna prints the individual pieces one by one. After some time, the first piece finished printing and Anna brings it to Joe's office.
Hey, the skull is done now. I'll just put it here on the table. And you can take a look at it when you have time.
Let's rewind for a moment. Joe is in focus mode, so Anna's message is automatically recorded without him noticing. Our system stores asynchronous events, including the recording and changes that occurred in the room. In this case, the skull on the table. Instead of notifying Joe, the system renders those changes as glossy shapes. At some point, Joe takes a break and turns around. He decides to check the new object on the table.
Hey, the skull is done now. I'll just put it here on the table, and you can take a look at it when you have time.
The object is now up to date in Joe's reality, and he can freely inspect it and interact with it. Afterwards, Joe resumes to his programming task and returns to focus mode. From then on, every hour or so, Anna drops by with another printed piece or some comments.
Hey, the left wing is done now. Let's check whether it fits. Mm-hmm. Seems alright. Could have been a bit better maybe. But I'll just put it here for now, and you can take a look at it.
This second event introduced two changes. The skull from event one was moved and the left wing was added.
So the right wing is done now, but it broke during the print, unfortunately. I'll just put it here for now, and then I will print it again.
The third event does not causally depend on the other two events because the broken wing is entirely separate. After initiating the reprint, Anna returns with an idea.
So earlier I said that the left wing didn't fit perfectly, right? So I was thinking about another idea for the next iteration. Instead of making two separate holes in the skull, we can instead choose to make one big hole through the skull, like this. It will give us some more freedom here in the middle. But yeah, think about it.
Let's look at this again. At the beginning of the event, Anna touched the left wing because she wants to talk about it at the whiteboard. This leads to event 4 being causally dependent on the wing from event 2. Also note that event 4 does not depend on the skull. After the message at the whiteboard, event 4 ends.
So I printed the right wing again and it worked this time, so I'll just put it here on the table and take the broken one with me.
All parts are finished now, but Anna has another idea and virtually teleports from her own office to Joe's office.
I took a look at the 3D models again, and another idea for the next iteration is to make this part here a bit smaller. So that's the part where the wings touch the skull from the outside. I hope that makes sense.
Remote events are added just like co-located events, and causalities are also inferred in the same way. This is the final causality graph after the 6 events. Note that our system generates the graph and visualization automatically, but does not show it to the user. Any object added or manipulated that is not a dependency for any event is rendered as a glossy shape. Those are the final states of the objects. Approaching them triggers playback of the associated event plus any causal dependencies. Joe is now done working on the game logic and closes the virtual workspace. He already knows about the skull on the table, but now he can see that the skull was moved and new objects were added.
Hey, the left wing is done now. Let's check whether it fits.
No further events depend on the skull, so Joe sees it live and can move it.
So earlier I said that the left wing didn't fit perfectly, right?
The left wing has no further events, so Joe can test how well it fits.
So the right wing is done now, but it broke during the print, unfortunately.
The final right wing has a causal dependency on its broken version, so events 3 and 5 are played back.
So I printed the right wing again, and it worked this time, so I'll just put it here on the table and take the broken one with me. I took a look at the 3D models again. And another idea for the next iteration is to make this part here a bit smaller. So that's the part where the wings touch the skull from the outside. I hope that makes sense.
After all events are played back, Joe gets back to his desk to make the changes suggested by Anna. But let's step back for a moment. Let's go back to the point in time when Joe finished programming. This time, Joe starts with the whiteboard. Now he triggers event 6 first. Due to the dependencies on events 1, 2, and 4, those need to be played back first in order that event 6 makes sense for Joe. Now Joe knows about the left wing and the updated sketch, so event 6 can be played back.
I took a look at the 3D models again.
Joe skips the playback of event 3 and 5, walks back to his desk and directly starts working on the changes described on the whiteboard. In the end, Anna prints the improved skull model for the final prototype. This concludes our scenario. For examples with more complex combinations of causalities as well as details about our detection approach, please read the paper.